We'll be here tomorrow to stand behind the work we did today.
Marv Albert covers all the sports, weekdays at 6.
2 nights ago, the Redmen of St. John's, the Quakers of Penn, continued their unexpected drive to the Final Four by knocking off Rutgers and Syracuse. Today, in the very backyard of the ACC teams they upset, the ACC Powers of Duke and North Carolina that they upset, St. John's and Penn will battle it out in the Eastern Regional Final. One team will finally adjust the glass slipper and become a surprising but invited guest next week in Salt Lake City. Hello, everybody. I'm Bryant Gumbel. Welcome to the Greensboro Coliseum, where today two surprises this championship chase will play for the right to represent the East. That's in game one of our doubleheader. In game two, Michigan State and Notre Dame will play for the Mideast crown. Both of them still expected to be playing at this point, so it's another big doubleheader. St. John's and Penn in the Cinderella Bowl, and then the depth of Notre Dame versus the magic of Irvin Johnson. All that coming up right here on NBC.
Today from Greensboro, North Carolina, NBC Sports presents the 1979 National Collegiate Basketball Championship Regional Finals. Brought to you by Lincoln Mercury. See all the 79s now during the big Show You the Light sales drive at the sign of the catch. By Gillette, makers of foamy shave cream. It's more than thick and rich enough. By Pabst Blue Ribbon. Pabst is proud to be the best. Naturally, with no artificial ingredients, and you can taste it. And by Allstate Insurance Companies. You're in good hands with Allstate.
We already know two of the teams in the Final Four. Yesterday on NBC in the Midwest Regional Finals, we saw Indiana State behind Larry Bird keep their unbeaten record intact by beating Arkansas. And then some drama from the West Coast, from Provo, where for the first time in 37 years, Ray Meyer has led his DePaul Blue Demons into the Final Four, leaving UCLA behind. Today in the Mideast, we'll watch two powerhouse teams go at it, the Michigan State Spartans against the Fighting Irish of Notre Dame. There can only be one survivor. And here on the floor of the Greensboro Coliseum, it belongs as a who-da-thunk-it. It is St. John's against Penn, and where are the ACC teams here in the backyard of North Carolina? You've got the scene for today's game. Let's turn it over to Jim Simpson and Billy Packer. Gentlemen?
You've got it, Brian. This is Billy Packer territory. The ACC is not here, and not many of their fans are here. But the number 9th and 10th seeded teams in the Eastern regions are here, Billy, and that's got to mean something.
Well, I think that's history, Jim, and I think that's history that'll never be repeated. Now that the NCAA is seeding the teams, it's almost inconceivable that 9th and 10th would be here. I never thought Penn should be the number 9th-rated club because they're an outstanding team. St. John's playing very well right now. I think we're going to see a super basketball game, two very well-coached teams, extreme quickness in the backcourt.
And, of course, one of his teams was on to Salt Lake City. We'll be back for the opening tip-off. It is Pennsylvania and St. John's coming up in just a moment.
I'm Howard Morgan, the TV weatherman in Albuquerque, New Mexico. We have a lot of sun out here. And the Goodyear Tiempo is the all-season tire that runs whisper quiet on sunny days.
And on rainy days, Goodyear Tiempo is the rain tire that keeps us moving. In the nearby mountains, it's also a snow tire. Goodyear Tiempo is the rain tire, snow tire, sun tire, one tire that does it all. Tiempo is the original all-season tire, only from Goodyear.
I thought a wagon had to be big to be roomy. Then Lincoln Mercury showed me the light with Zephyr.
Order this 3.3-liter Zephyr wagon, and you can get a luxury option package at 25% off during our big Shows You the Light sales drive. Order this 2.3-liter Bobcat wagon, and you can get a package of special options at 25% off. We're out to sell a total of 200,000 new cars in our big sales drive.
Let your Lincoln Mercury dealer show you the light now.
Ladies and gentlemen, introducing the starting lineups for today's NCAA East Regional Finals. For the University of Pennsylvania, at forward, number 15, Tony Price. For St. John's University, at forward, number 43, Frank Gilroy. For the University of Pennsylvania, at forward, number 20, Tim Smith. For St. John's University, at forward, number 22, Ron Clair. For the University of Pennsylvania at center, number 21, Matt White. For St. John's University at forward, number 55, Wayne McCoy. For the University of Pennsylvania at guard, number 3, James Salters. For St. John's University at guard, number 35, Reggie Carter. For the University of Pennsylvania at guard, number 32, Bobby Willis. For St. John's University at guard, number 5, Bernard Rencher. And the head coaches, Bob Weinauer of Pennsylvania and Lou Carnesecca of St. John's University.
These two teams are no strangers to postseason play. For St. John's, it is their 37th appearance. At Pennsylvania, 5 times in the last 9 years they've been in the NCAA. And they're about to send off here in Greensboro, North Carolina for the Eastern Regional Championship.
Sold out again.
The new improved Gillette Track 2, please.
Say, who needs improved when these twin blades will do?
Track 2 has micro-smooth edges. Makes the blade smoother than ever.
Shave better than me?
Better, safer, smoother.
And comfortable.
Comfort, schmumfort. You don't have the... But...
Do you have the new improved Gillette Track 2?
Improved Track 2? Improved Track 2?
The new improved Gillette Track 2. Micro-smooth edges make it a better shave.
There's something about a Kawasaki. Something deep inside. That moves you, haunts you, thrills you, taunts you, makes you wanna ride.
This year, the 79 Kawasaki's are dazzling eye grabbers that come with whatever muscle you need. 400, 650s, or 1000s. Street bikes that move as good as they look.
So don't let the good times pass you by. Don't let the good times.
Pennsylvania, 24-5 on the air. St. John's, 21-10. Here are our officials. Don Shea out of Atlanta in the Sun Belt Conference. Reggie Copeland, our referee, out of the Southeast Conference, lives in Mobile, Alabama. And Gary Muncy of Fort Wayne, a Big Ten official. Pennsylvania will be in the dark red or the darker uniforms. St. John's in the white uniforms with the red trim. Price and Smith at the forwards for Pennsylvania. White at center. Willis and Salters the guards. For St. John's, Clair and Gilroy up front. McCoy at center. Rencher and Carter the guards. And the winner, we'll repeat ourselves, goes on to Salt Lake. Now meet the winner of the game coming up later today between Michigan State and Notre Dame. And this ball is out of bounds and belongs to Pennsylvania.
Jim, there's a case, toss it in. There's a case of not having your hands right up in the air in a catching position. McCoy had 2 taps at the ball, got it to his teammate, lost it out of bounds.
Salters, with the ball right now, had the free throw that beat North Carolina. That's Smith. Here's big Matt White out of Bethesda, Maryland, outside. A walk-on out of Choate School. Here's Willis, the leader in assists. Price and Salters again in the corner. Man-to-man employed by St. John's. Lou Carnesecca does not like zone defense. Coach it or play against it. Smith is loose, and there is the first 2 points of the ball game. Tim Smith.
We're going to
they're gonna have to stop the game. Stand by, folks. Now, Billy Packer, you got a chance.
Well, a straight man-to-man by St. John's out there in a wide-open offense. Matt White, not known as an offensive threat. Therefore, McCoy's going to slough off of him. But when you take the chance to slough off a postman that comes outside, of course, that always opens up a passing lane for him. So I think we're going to see that man-to-man. And the guy to look for in this particular offense is Tony Price from Penn. Clair's really going to have a job with him.
Lou Carnesecca, 11th-year head coach, St. John's. And, of course, the man at the other end for Pennsylvania is Bob Weinauer, completing his 2nd year in Pennsylvania. Funny thing, when they take the streamers off the floor, usually they wind them up and save them for another time. There's Weinauer, 2nd-year head coach. He'd been a coach in, well, a matter of fact, out in Long Island, the Massapequa, before going on to become an assistant at Pennsylvania. When Chuck Daly left, he took over.
And, Jim, he's been an outstanding coach in more than basketball, so he's just a guy that has it in his blood.
This is Rencher, number 5, in backcourt with Carter, 35. There's McCoy coming out.
the high post. The player will take a lot of shots from the top of the key.
On the other hand, here we have a 2-3 zone by Penn, a little half-court zone pressure they used before. They played the zone well and have good quickness out front.
Right there it is. Ball off the hands of McCoy into the hands of Smith, who has the only basket. Willis down court. Willis loves to drive, but cannot.
He was a point guard last year. Now with Booney Saunders in the game, gives him two great quick guards.
Smith loose. Matt White takes the shot. In and out. Another rebound. Price. He's fouled.
They could call it on either Flair or Gilroy. Gilroy's a great jumper inside. You can see right here with White going up for the shot. He's hit 60%. Doing a good job. Price gets it in there. There's Gilroy and Flair going up. They wanted the block, but it wasn't there.
Tony Price, the Ivy League Player of the Year. The foul was on Gilroy. That's the first foul of the game. Price is also the most valuable player while playing for Taft High School in New York City, but escaped down the line to Pennsylvania. And it's 4-0.
Here's that zone pressure again.
Cost him a foul, I believe, on Flair.
Now, it's really interesting to see this zone pressure that they're using. And they're using their big people up front. That gives them a fellow like Booney Saunders to be in the back line here with his quickness to intercept the passes that go over the zone press.
That foul was on Willis.
There's the 2-3 zone again.
Wrencher from way outside. Whistle blows underneath. And a foul underneath.
Now, Bernie's a transfer from Notre Dame. You think he's not involved in basketball in both of these games. His old teammates, and of course, this big one for him today. Go back straight man to man again, Jim, and you can see how wide open it is since they don't use Dwight as an active offensive threat in the post.
Underneath. Shot by Saunders, no good. Off the hands of Carter, can't get a shot away. It's 4-0 Pennsylvania.
Gilroy showed what an outstanding leaper he is on that last play, and that's something that the Penn guards are going to have to be aware of.
McCoy had the winning shot the other night, misses this one, and White gets his second rebound. Matt White has one at each end of the court now. Willis drives, puts it up. Oh, super shot. 6-0 Pennsylvania.
Here's the full court pressure again. Smith, the forward, plays the point in that pressure and drops all the way back to the left-hand side of the court to be on the defender.
McCoy over his head, then tips it up and in.
The tip in by Wayne McCoy.
And now they're going to have to stop again. St. John's has scored, and so the Redmen fans from across the court throw their streamers on the court. It is 6-2 Pennsylvania. Not yet 3 minutes gone by. The ninth and tenth seeded teams, which was ninth, Pennsylvania, which was tenth, St. John's, they were happy to get a bid after being beaten out in their own conference. Saunders drives all the way in, puts it up, no good. Carter has the rebound.
And that's been the key to their offense, penetration, and they just didn't hit the easy shot. Foul.
Carter misses. McCoy comes up with it, and a foul is called on Tony Price. That's one on Price. Willis has one. There are two on St. John's players, Flair and Gilroy.
Long.
Price, the leading scorer, the leading rebounder.
There was a foul, I thought, on White right before that, and then a foul on Price against McCoy, and I'm sure that Bob Warnow would rather the first one have been called.
McCoy takes a lot of shots from there, no good, and White's got to get another rebound. White is prone to get in foul trouble, but he's been very evident by his rebounding today. Whoops, hold it. 3 seconds, and that's going to be charged against White.
3 second lane violation.
Jim, they used White for an awful lot of high screens, and with such great quickness in the backcourt, they have an offense without even a pass. And the fact that they get penetration, the ball gets inside, then they play it 5-on-4, 4-on-3.
Wrencher trying to get something started. The player comes all the way over and puts it in. Long player.
Basket by Ron Flair.
It was 6-0, now it's 6-4. Here's Willis driving, passing off, easy basket.
Same deal.
And scored by 10-6.
The team that wins this ball game is going to be the first team that can cut off the penetration by the guards, because they're just generating their own offense.
Smith has 4 points. Line pass. Still blind. McCoy hardly saw it coming. Went off his hands and out of bounds.
Pretty good pass, though. Once again, good penetration.
No substitutions yet. This is Bobby Willis, Colt captain. Outstanding man and assist. You saw one of that last time down court. Puts a blow. Foul called.
On Bobby Willis.
Offensive call.
Foul on an offensive screen set play that time by Penn.
And that'll be the second on Bobby Willis. The third team foul. Remember, Billy and I'll be picking the Gillette Most Valuable Player. $1,000 to that school in a letter yesterday over at Cincinnati. We had to pick two in the same game. Player shoots from outside and scores.
Well, that's good recognition. Penn went to a 1-3-1 zone that time, Jim, and St. John's picked it up right away.
Smith has to pass outside. Willis can't get the shot away. Hold it.
It'll be on Gilroy for holding.
Three wide with a hold.
That'll be the second for Gilroy.
Penn is really a tough team to defense because they play with an open offense a lot, Jim, and all four of their other players can drive well with the ball.
There's Willis. Team fouls are all even, three apiece. The Cinderella teams of Eastern Regional. There's a steal by Flair as Price went up to shoot. Salters gets a hand in there, and it is Flair who loses the ball out of bounds.
Really good hustle.
Took the ball out of the hands of Tony Price, had it wide open. Salters, much the shorter man, away from the ball, still able to discombobulate Flair and have him lose it out of bounds. 8-6 Pennsylvania. 15 minutes, 20 seconds to go, first half. Later today, Michigan State and Notre Dame will then know the Final Four. As Price shooting, White's got the ball for his fourth rebound, and Carter draws his first personal foul.
Now, Louis Carnesecca really upset with that. One of the great coaches in college basketball right now, telling his fellas to calm down a little bit. But he's right, it should have been a jump ball.
Matt White, a 70% foul shooter. At the line, he is also the winner of a National Piano Teachers Award. Went to Choate, came on as a walk-on, and here he is playing in an Eastern Regional as a starting center for Pennsylvania. And has a point, his first.
And really contributing, Jim, if you take a look at this ball club, they could not do without him, even though they do have some subs at that post position. He's the guy that gives them the size in there.
He's been a strong rebounder thus far. Smith battling for it. Picked up and underneath and put in by number 32 Willis. He has 4 points. Smith has 4 points.
Now here's a 2-2-1 full court press. Penn gives you an awful lot of looks defensively. Smart ball club.
Quakers lead by five and go back into that zone. Carter, he's the hot shooter, but a hand on it by Willis. Goes over to Rencher, who gets the shot away and scores. 11-8.
No time to relax, boy. They get the ball down the court quickly.
Defenses, man-to-man for St. John's. And zone for Pennsylvania. Here's Rencher. Willis covering on Rencher. Over to Carter. He can't handle it. And he's hit by Smith. That's why he couldn't handle it.
Yeah, that was a pass a little bit tough to handle because it was just so quickly thrown right down on a man.
Time is called. We're in Greensboro. 14 minutes and 20 seconds to go. First half, Pennsylvania's led all the way at one time by 6-0. Pennsylvania 11, St. John's 8. We go back to our studios now for this message.
It's raining, Ollie.
I can see that.
Your wife is sure I'm making a mess.
Well, why don't you do something to help me? Oh!
Once a year, it makes sense to get yourself a new set of Anko wiper blades. It's simple, quick, and an inexpensive way to see your way clear again.
That's much better, Ollie.
Why, thank you, Stanley.
Mike is up. And they're all
first run and he went out and won. Now it's all behind. Got blue ribbon on my mind. I've got Pabst Blue Ribbon on my mind.
There are a lot of beers, but there's only one Pabst. It's brewed to be the best, naturally, with no artificial ingredients, and you can taste it.
Thrown inside of Reggie Carter. Now look at how that ball is thrown down inside. Smith coming from behind. Gives him a little knee, drives him out of bounds. Carter probably doesn't feel too good, but he's happy to have an opportunity.
Pennsylvania thanks in large part to Matt White out rebounding. St. John's 7-4. Turnovers are even. They've got three apiece, and the score is 11-8. Well, I said at the end of the day, we'll know the final four that goes on to Salt Lake City. A week from today, we'll know the final two that'll be in the final. They're getting close. Wrenching to put it in. Carter's a good shot. Puts it up, but does not hit that one. And it is battled away by Willis. The two guards were there, Willis and Salt.
Still man to man. Everything spread out. There's a lot of room for penetration. Right now, Carter's wide open, and can't hit it. Sometimes you're too wide open, Jim. The toughest shot to make. Remember Larry Bird yesterday? The only one he really didn't hit cleanly.
McCoy has not been shooting well today. Did not shoot early the other night, but got the final basket to put St. John's in the regional final.
St. John's picking up their defense.
Now, Smith is, Price is wide open, and he misses. And Gilroy's got the rebound. Quakers have had a couple of good shots down court and failed to convert either one of them.
Man-to-man now by Penn is switching things up.
There's Carter. Salters is on in.
What a great
hit away by Salters. That's his second fine defensive play. Smith. Now shooting. No good. Knocked out of bounds. Three times they've had opportunities down court and three times they missed on shots. And St. John's now has a chance to draw within one.
Jim, let's see if Penn stays in the man-to-man defense. If they do, Carter's going to take Salters down inside to try to post him low.
Carter hasn't scored.
There he is, right away. Takes him down inside.
And that's a good score. You're right, but that's a good score.
Bob Weinheimer won't stay in that man-to-man defense long with that situation.
11-10, the closest St. John's has been since the beginning. Price comes in and quickly gets his first basket, now has 4 points.
Real good hard ball fake there. Here we have the full court pressure now, zone again.
2-on-1, but they cover up quickly. McCoy along the baseline, backdoors it. This is the view that Billy and I have. You're right down on the floor next to us. Ooh, all knocked away by McCoy, and he's going to be called with a foul. That is his first.
Strong young man, one of the highest recruited individuals in high school out of Long Island that there was going up against the kids. It's a walk-on. Here's McCoy coming on through. Drives Tony Price almost back to half court.
That is the fifth team foul against St. John. Tony Price will toss it in. Smith, who had two early baskets, hadn't scored since. White almost had the ball knocked away by McCoy. Far from a capacity crowd here. Most people thought it was going to be an ACC team. Price gets in and is fouled in the act of shooting. And that'll be on Flair in his second.
Jim, I think it's going to be on McCoy coming on across there. We'll have to see.
Yeah, you're right, I'm wrong. That'll be his second.
He's trying to help out a lot. And when Price gets down inside like that, Flair really has trouble handling him. He's a strong individual. There you see McCoy coming on across with a foul.
Price is now 3-for-3 and has 5 points. And it's 14-12.
He's been a real point machine in the regional playoffs so far.
Picked up by Carter. Gordon Thomas is in for St. John's number 32. He's quite a shooter. Tackle him in and take out Gilroy.
But Thomas had a big night against Rutgers. He is a shooter and looks to put it up there.
Now they got Thomas loose. He doesn't get it, but it's got the rebound. Nice in the high post of Matt White underneath. And Wayne got it out again. And that'll be his third. Wayne McCoy with 11:30 to go in the first half now has three personal fouls. And very quickly, Lou Conoseca goes to the bench.
Well, give White a great deal of credit here for getting in position, because he felt that McCoy had turned his head a little bit to look for the passing lane. No question about the foul there coming on down top.
Rudy Wright, number 44, an outstanding rebounder, a senior out of Long Island City, comes in to replace McCoy. And Matt White at the line. He is 1-for-2 from the line.
Rudy is a real worker, Jim, and I think they won't fall off that much early in the game. They're used to having McCoy in foul trouble. Seems to be the pattern of play for St. John.
There's McCoy taking his seat on the Bayside, New York, and here's White out of Bethesda, Maryland. He's now 3-for-4, 3 points. And it's 16-12. They're in the bonus situation. Pennsylvania out rebounding St. John's 11-7. And St. John's has lost McCoy. But repeat, Rudy Wright can get the job done.
Now you have Ken Hall in the ballgame, too. Watch this press. Everybody overplaying here. A lot of quickness.
There's Willis. And he is fouled by Rencher. Now Willis took the shot. Salters has gone out, and Ken Hall has replaced him. That's kind of a routine substitution for Bobby Warnow.
Kind of interesting in the program, the University of Pennsylvania talking about Booney Salters, said he's not expected to play much. And here he's been one of the vital guys for their team all year and, of course, been a real factor in the playoffs.
There's Willis. 63% free throw shooter.
Forget it out.
I was at Indiana State yesterday. Free throw shooter. That's 6 points for Bobby Willis. Now you can see the empty seats. When the Atlantic Coast Conference teams, Duke and Carolina, got out of there, that just took the crowd right out of Greensboro. Here's Rudy Wright. He can get in play. Back to Gordon Thomas.
Handled the press well that time. Still the 2-3 zone by Penn. Right now in the middle.
Gordon Thomas gets his shot away, and for the second time, he's short. The other night, he couldn't miss.
Oh, good pass.
Great. Look at that. And Hall cannot handle it. Great pass from Willis to Hall, his backcourt teammate. And he couldn't handle it.
Pennsylvania breaks very well. You see the pass right there. Of course, Willis, a left-hander anyway, just took his eyes off the ball to Ken Hall and just went out of the hand.
Pennsylvania by six again. 18-12. They led 6-0. Thomas and Cripps.
Oh,
well, we saw that play yesterday, and that was a big play.
Well, there's a case where a man tripped over another man's foot that wasn't stuck out there to try to trip him at all. He just happened to have it planted.
Big play yesterday in the closing moments of the Indiana State game. Well, we'll come back in a moment. It's 18-12. Pendleton St. John.
Some of my best clients I've had for 7 years, are also some of my best friends. I like to think I'm a nice enough person, but believe me, charm doesn't keep a client for 7 years. Nobody can guarantee a winner. But I work for Bache because Bache understands the importance of good brokers. Bache gives us every kind of investment tool and really tries to make me a winner with every one of my clients. And that hasn't hurt the friendships at all.
The winning attitude at Bache. Put it to work for you.
The best is yet to come, and babe, won't it be fine?
For 1979, a beautiful new styling of Lincoln Versailles.
Best is yet to come.
The pride of owning a Lincoln distilled to a 110-inch wheelbase. The pleasure of driving in luxury. And now, each Versailles offers a choice of three roof designs. Until you experience the Lincoln Versailles, we think the best is yet to come.
Come the day you're mine.
You'll see the best in ladies' golf in the Women's Kemper Open and the Colgate Dynasure Winner's Circle on consecutive weekends starting March 31st on NBC.
Well, I look forward to it. I'm going to get together with an old gang of mine. Carol Mann, Marlene Floyd, Mary B. Porter, Susan O'Connor, Kathy Dugan. We've got the Women's Kemper Open in a couple of weeks. And follow immediately from Palm Springs, the Dynasure Winner's Circle tournament. Look forward to both of those tournaments. So just to show you what's going on in rebounding, Pennsylvania, Matt White has 5 rebounds. Willis has 4, Price 3. There's nobody on St. John's with more than 2. And St. John's has not scored in 2 minutes and 5 seconds in this 18-12 game.
And Jim, very importantly, they have McCoy on the bench with 3 fouls.
Hall and Willis remain your backcourt duo for Pennsylvania. Up front, they've got Smith, White, and Fife. Gordon Thomas is on Smith, White.
Good team movement inside.
Whoop, off. He kept it in there, and I think Smith is going to save it. Fine play by Willis. He's been their outstanding offensive player for the 3 years he's been on the varsity. Here's Fife. Ivy League most valuable player, but he misses that shot. White knocks it back and maybe called with a foul. And for Matt White, that will be his first. He has fouled out a number of times, 13 times this year.
Well, he reached over the back right there. And Jim, it's not unusual for a man of his size to foul out a lot when he's playing with a much smaller group of teammates. He doesn't get a lot of power help in there, just quick. Still the 2-3 zone, but they're pressing a little differently out of it.
Carter, their leading scorer. No good. Carter's only got 2 points. That's when he took a man inside of the man-to-man defense. Against the zone, he has not scored.
That's a foul.
That's
Bernie Renter.
That's his second. And remember, they are in a bonus situation.
That's a beautiful change of pace dribble by Bobby Willis that time. Coming down the court, he really set up Bernie Renter well.
It'll be Willis at the line, 1-1. Great game yesterday, some surprises. Congratulations, Ray Myers, 37 years at the fall. Whatever UCLA had, congratulations to Bill Hodges and the Indiana State Sycamores.
There was that change of pace in there, and Renter, of course, when he saw it coming, tried to put a hand out to feed the progress, and picked up the foul.
This is the biggest lead so far, 8 points.
And into the 1-1 very early, Jim.
Rudy Wright gets it in the bucket. Pass down
on the ground.
That's a bad pass.
Weiss trying to score. Does not. Will go in for him. I think White's got his second foul. Reaching around. Matt White picks up his second foul. Gilroy's going to come back in for St. John's. And it looks like it's going to be Leafson coming in for, and that's who it is, Tom Leafson, a freshman out of Dublin, New Jersey. Coming in for Pennsylvania. Now that's the foul that Matt White picked up. That is the 16th foul against Pennsylvania. Leafson, there's Ponoseco, who just came in. Heavily recruited. I asked a little story about him a couple weeks ago in a magazine about how his family just could not cope with the heavy recruiting that he got as an outstanding high school senior. That's right. Not showing the good hands there. Couldn't grab the ball, and now we've got a jump ball.
Gilroy fired that ball on across. Wasn't actually in position to make the catch.
Wright talking to Gilroy. They slap hands and now Wright steps in. Ball will be kept inbounds but thrown back to Smith. Now knocked out of bounds again. Willis knocked it out of the hands of Reggie Carter.
Boy, Ken Hall really did a job on that jump ball, Jimmy. He was concentrating perfectly. He met the toss just as it reached its peak. Only about 6'2", but really did a job.
Watch these teams closely. One goes on to Salt Lake.
Notice how Bobby Willis leaves his zone to go out and press occasionally, which leaves a hole in behind him. So far, St. John's hasn't been able to pick it up.
Carter, excellent outside shooter. Again, has a bad shot. Wright passes the ball over. And it's on Tony Price. He draws his second personal foul. Pennsylvania's outscored St. John's 7-2 in the last 3 minutes. And leads 20-14.
Second.
I'm sure Louis Carnesecca is really upset about the fact that he can't get Carter started with his jump shooting. He had the shot there about the third time. See, Louis talking to him right now, saying, come on, take it easy. Just keep firing it up, it'll go.
Gilroy at the line as they've now reached the 1-1, the bonus situation. Both teams in the bonus situation with nearly 9 minutes to go. First point for Frank Gilroy, young sophomore out of Whitestone, New York.
shot, gentlemen.
20 to 15. St. John's keeps falling behind and then coming back, creeping back.
That's the story of their ball club. They've been doing it all year long. When they get behind, they seem to never be out of it.
Ladies and gentlemen, they're down by eight, now they're down by four.
For your own safety and for the convenience of our other spectators,
a little half-court zone pressure on their part. Playing a 1-3-1 zone right now.
Smith hasn't been able to get a shot away. Willis is not clear. Thought he was for a moment. Thomas came up, picked him up. Now Thomas kicked the ball, and so it'll be out of bounds to Pennsylvania.
Bubby Willis really has excellent fundamentals as a backcourt player. Good pump fakes with the shoulder and the hands. Always under control. There's the zone right now. 1-2-2 on the out of bounds.
On the second doesn't like it, but those who live by the zone have to die by it, I guess. Or if you can't beat them, join them. One of the two.
Well, I think this takes away some of the quickness of penetration that Penn had going for him. We'll see what it does with Price, who's a good outside shooter.
Moved the ball around very nicely, but St. John's very quick to cover up. Now, Willis takes the shot. No good, and the rebound goes right
through. Oh, good
steal. Taken by Leeson, and Willis puts it in.
He's in.
Willis.
Trying to be a little bit too cool out there with the ball, Jim. And Willis and Hall are using their quick hands to get the ball away from him. There he is again, almost losing it.
Now he takes the shot, and it is no good. And look at that rebound by Smith. Got above the rim. That's what Willis likes to do, to drive, but it didn't work. Lead pass to Thomas, but it's too far. There, let it get away from him. And time has been called. Only to let some folks into the ball game.
Ron Player returns to the St. John's lineup.
Salters comes back in.
Here we talk about fundamental, Jim. That was a pass off the dribble with a left hand. Really no angle on it at all. Very poorly thrown.
Salters has come back in, and Vincent Ross, 22, comes in for the first time today. Pennsylvania, Hall, Salters, Price, Ross, and Leafson.
St. John's goes back to man-to-man.
That's Hall beating it right to Player. To Thomas, and that's Salters. He'll draw the foul. Salters has made a fine couple of defensive plays, but that time he reached in and got caught.
Well, he's a little late getting over there, but he has super quickness. And, you know, Player has shown us some real fine defensive play down the other end of court for St. John's. He's been matched up with Price and really doing a nice job.
St. John's now has Player, Potter, Wright, Thomas, and Gilroy. One and one, remember, and Thomas not a real good foul shooter, less than 60%, but an outstanding outside shooter. Sometimes you can't figure that out. A man can be good from the outside, yet step to the line and not be able to hit the foul shot.
Jim, I think it's all a matter of concentration, because if a man has a touch, he ought to be able to make foul shots.
Well, he made two right there, and it's 22-18. Pennsylvania now up only by four, but up by as much as eight.
Back to the zone again. Both coaches really trying to work on some strategy here. And Penn's going to keep the ball outside to look it over.
That's Vincent Ross, the freshman from Philadelphia. And Leeson is also a freshman, so they got two freshmen in there for Pennsylvania. Reaching in, Thomas draws the foul. Or is it Carter? Carter. If so, that's even worse for St. John's because that's his second. And he's their leading scorer. They're in a bonus situation, remember. The term student athlete epitomizes participation in intercollegiate athletics while pursuing a college education. Each year, 80 NCAA postgraduate scholarships worth $1,500 each are awarded to student athletes who have maintained at least a B average throughout their college careers. The presentation of this year's 15 scholarships in basketball, the NCAA has presented nearly $1.5 million to over 1,000 student athletes. The preceding message furnished by the NCAA. Price is now 4-for-6. Who's it belong to?
No question about
right.
That. But Ken Hall did a good job. Their guards are real fine rebounders. Gilroy's a leaper, had his hands on it, and Hall got a piece.
6.5 minutes left. Pennsylvania by 5. Carter with 2 fouls, only has 1 basket. He is their leading scorer. better than 15 points a game. Now in underneath, and there's number points made by Flair. Now Flair has three baskets, 6 points.
Really right, Billy does a nice job coming off the bench.
St. John's has called within three. There's Leeson. Paul, hold it.
Good call. Bison trying to set a screen in the inside.
Well, Philadelphia fans, Pennsylvania fans, that's the third by my count on Tony Price. They can ill afford to use him.
And you want to give Flair a lot of credit for keeping Price under control here early in the ballgame.
Bobby Wanamaker makes a move, gets Smith back in, Price goes to the bench. Ben Boy is on the bench for St. John.
Penn's having to go to the bench a little bit more than they'd like to, I'm sure, particularly with Price out of there.
Player takes another shot and has another shot. That means that St. John's has now outscored Pennsylvania 10-3 in the last 4 minutes. And it's 23-22.
Jim, the zone will be more effective now with Price out of the ballgame. He's their key shooter against it. And Lou Cornacek is going to stay with the zone.
Shoulders will slow things down just a bit. Setting it up. A couple of freshmen in this Eastern Regional final here for Pennsylvania.
Bobby Willis out of the ballgame, too. Another shooter.
Smith is a good shooter, but not this time. And Flair's got the rebound. Ball was a little long. Carter loves to hit from right there and does not. And Rudy Wright, tough rebounder, gets it and then just throws it down. Now for the first time, St. John's has the chance to go ahead.
And still play in the zone.
They leave it to their shooter and again he misses. And up under there is Vincent Ross. First chance St. John's has had to go ahead since the opening tip-off, and then Paul just makes sure they do not by knocking one in from the corner.
Not many zones, Jim, designed to stop that shot.
4:20 to go. First half. Oh, my. Thomas decided not to shoot the shot, took it into the corner, trying to get it into Flair, and Flair does an excellent job under the basket. Little fake and drew the foul.
Ron Flair is really having a fine first half. Nice, solid ball player, playing well within himself. Bobby Willis in the
lineup. Time has been called. 4:10 to go. Pennsylvania leading St. John's, 25-22.
At Pioneer, we don't build a high-fidelity receiver the way some of our competitors do. Instead of a press-board bottom, our SX780 has a metal one that limits interference. It has power meters and a DC power supply for richer bass. It's things like this that have made Pioneer number one among people who care about music. And isn't that why you buy high-fidelity components? Because you care about music? Pioneer's SX780.
Boy, did I save money on this hat.
Yeah?
We smart shoppers compare prices.
Wish we could do that with our homeowner's insurance.
Compare with Allstate.
Compare?
Bring in your homeowner's policy and compare rates. Odds are Allstate might save you some money.
We can save you some money.
It does pay to compare.
Oh, it sure does. Love your hat.
Oh. Hey, where'd you get the hat?
You're in good hands with Allstate.
And that's a promise from us, the good hands people.
On Sports World, the Wild and Woolly All-Ireland Hurling Finals from Dublin, plus Notre Dame's annual Bengal Bouts Boxing Tournament, today on NBC.
Well, you know it's the day after St. Paddy's Day, but we have a celebration on Sports World, and how about this, the All-Ireland Hurling Championships from Dublin, of course, and then the University of Notre Dame Bengal Bouts, where the Fighting Irish of Notre Dame fight the Fighting Irish of Notre Dame. 4:10 to go, 25-22, Pennsylvania over St. John's. Each team has a big man in trouble. Foul-wise, Price has three on him, and McCoy, the big man for St. John's, also has three. And Flair's at the line. He's hit on four baskets. That has been very effective underneath.
Flair's even telling people where to go, Jim. Been a real key in this first half. As I said, he did a good job on Tony Price, and he's taking good shot selection on his part down the other end of the floor.
That is a take-charge man, and is a sophomore out of Elmhurst, New York.
Here's a foul inside. Just held his ground down there and then tried to go up, and of course was hit by two people.
Ross drew the foul.
Right, Ross had the foul.
10 points, player. He and Bobby Willis tied for the scoring lead. And St. John's down by a single point. It's been down by as much as 8. Later today, Michigan State and Notre Dame.
Then they come back to man-to-man after the timeout situation. Even though the zone was effective, they want to get a little different look.
Easton trying to get it inside. Cannot. Pennsylvania and St. John. There's Willis forcing a shot.
Oh, Willis is down.
He got hit in the mouth. To the nose. Nozo Mountie is up. White has the ball knocked away and is picked out by Ross. The two freshmen working on him will watch Willis. Paul is getting up to come in to replace him. And Willis just put his hand up like, I'm okay. Salters takes the shot. And this one goes in. And James Collins Booney has his first basket, 27-24.
2-2-1 full court press again. St. John's recognized as well. Let's see if they go back to the zone, Jim, because it's a much better defense against Penn with this personnel than the man-to-man.
They're in the zone. Wrencher from far outside. Four boards for Bernard Wrencher. 27-26. There's Smith taking it to the basket. Fine play. Ross follows and puts it in. Vincent Ross, freshman, scores.
What's happening is that Penn's quickness has such penetration against St. John's that in the man-to-man, they just can't stop somebody from getting inside.
Zone again. Beat him underneath Blair, but it was a bad pass. And Blair, now there's another bad pass. Simply thrown out of bounds by Vincent Ross. Made a good play at one end of the court. Throws the ball away at the other. 29-26. Started to say, Billy, these two teams have only met 3 times in history. And the last time St. John's won, are you ready? 1910.
Well, it's absolutely amazing, isn't it? You figure two teams have been powers and big names in basketball in the East for a long, long time.
Gilroy from the side. Nope, goes over the backboard, belongs to Pennsylvania. These teams seated 9th and 10th in the Eastern Regional Finals. Halftime, Del Griffith to Louisville, they're out of it. But Ray Meyer, coach of the Paul for 37 years, he is definitely in it. 65 years old, he's got his team in the Final Four.
That's quite a story, of course, particularly going up against Phil Hodges, doing such a great job in his first year of coaching.
That's one of our games next week. Beat is high, Ross cannot handle it. Out of bounds, and St. John's has a chance to get it for all within one.
You know, Jim, I think also just reflecting about yesterday, how Bob King must feel inside to know that he helped put together that fine team they have at Indiana State to know that they're going on to the Final Four.
The only reason he didn't coach him and Bill Hodges did is illness on behalf of Bob King. But he is well and on the campus of Indiana State.
Zone again, Penn State primarily in the zone.
Gilroy's trying to break it and does not. That's Smith. His second personal foul. Remember, everybody's in the one-on-one situation.
Here we'll see a case of hands. Now watch Rudy Wright. He's had a hard time holding on the ball all day. That one gets away from him. But there's a foul down over the top. Carter going to the line.
Gordon Thomas coming in. Gilroy's had a couple of outside shots from the left side and has missed them. And now they're putting Gordon Thomas in his spot. He is an excellent outside shooter. And it might be that Carter second figures he might hit him.
Well, I think that's a good substitution also from a standpoint of rebounding. St. John's is balanced up fairly well right now in size, so they can afford to go to the shooter.
Here is Carter. He only has one basket. First time at the foul line. And doesn't get it. And look at Ross get up there. 1:20 left. First half, little to choose between them. Pennsylvania's led by as many as 8.
And here you see the zone again, Jim. Much better design to go ahead and play against this quick Penn team.
1:10 left. Hall, Salters. Willis did go out after taking the shot to the nose and mouth.
You admire about great coaching like Louis Carnesecca. Even though he doesn't like to play the zone, he knows it's best suited for the game, so he's not going to be stubborn.
Less than a minute to go, 50 seconds to go. Ross almost lost it away. And now, Salters will bring it out and slow it down again.
Are they going to go for one now? They've got it out here. And, of course, the officials are now will start warning St. John's because they've got to come out and play being behind.
Weinauer is telling them to get moving, too, not stand out there. He said, move it around. 28 seconds left. 29-26, Pennsylvania. Whoops.
Ooh, that's dangerous. Unless you're going to take the shot, there's no need to get it in there and play with it.
15 seconds. You're watching the clock.
Here they go.
There's Matt White. Doesn't get it. He's walking with the ball. They had the ball with 1:10 to go. Took a shot with about 8 seconds left.
Carter better move it up the court. Well,
oh, good. No good. And Pennsylvania has the lead after leading by as many as 8 at the halftime, 29-26. The Neeson Regionals, Greensboro, North Carolina. And we'll come back after this word from your studio.
What's real today? Artificial this, artificial that? It's almost everywhere, but not in Pabst beers.
Because Pabst won't shortcut nature with chemicals or artificial ingredients. Pabst Blue Ribbon, Pabst Extra Light, Andecker.
Pabst brews the best taste in beer, honestly.
Quality since 1844.
Ortho.
Growing a lush green carpet like this isn't easy.
Our concern is growing.
But being a leader in home gardening,
Ortho.
Ortho can help.
Keeps it going.
Ortho lawn food contains all the primary plant nutrients for a thick, beautiful, velvety green lawn. Ortho lawn food, more proof that our concern for lawns is always growing.
Always growing.
You want tough? Take a ride in a cop car. Few cars take more punishment than a cop car. That's why Motorcraft quality spark plugs from Ford are being tested in 64 big city cop cars from GM, Chrysler, and Ford. So far, after a total of 750,000 miles, not one Motorcraft spark plug failed. These plugs got guts. Get tough. Get Motorcraft spark plugs tested tough in big city cop cars.
Is Gillette Foamy thick and rich enough to stop this super sports car?
No.
Is Foamy thick and rich enough to support this lovely lady?
No.
Is Foamy thick and rich enough to hold up this husky hiker?
No.
But if you want a clean, close shave, it's more than thick and rich enough.
We are at ACC territory, but Carolina and Duke are not here, and so you can see all of the empty seats. Everybody thought they would be here. Nor is Louisville in the Final Four, but Dale Griffith is a fine player for them. And Raymar DePaul, who would have thought it, that they would make it to the Final Four? They have, and there are features at halftime. Dale Griffith and Raymar's at DePaul. And we'll come back to Greensboro, North Carolina, for Bryant Gumbel and those messages to Pro Kids. Halftime basketball report after these messages from your local station.
Cliffhangers, three action shows in one suspense-filled hour. In the next chilling chapter of Dracula 79, will the Count make merry into his creature of darkness? Can she resist his passion and power? Dracula 79, plus Stop Susan Williams and The Secret Empire. Tuesday, they don't call them cliffhangers for nothing.
This is Firestone's famous deluxe champion Super Belt tire. If you need tires this month, this is the tire to buy. During March and March only, this Firestone double belted tire is on sale for as little as $28. The smooth ride and long wear of Firestone's famous double belted deluxe champion for just $28. During March only, and only at Firestone.
Join Rip Taylor in the $1.98 Beauty Show Tuesday night at 7:30.
ProCAD's College Basketball Report. Brought to you by ProCAD's,
For all those moments, you feel like a pro.
Pro Kids invite you to spend a Tuesday night with Rich and the boys for a friendly game of basketball. No, it's not the NBA. Some nights Rich couldn't buy a basket, but it's tough. That's why we gave Rich's Pro Kids a sure grip sole, leather uppers for firm support, and an inner sole to cushion the pounding. Because when Rich feels the magic, you'd swear the ball had eyes.
Pro Kids, for all those moments, you feel like a pro.
Hello again, everyone. Bryant Gumbel back with you. We're at halftime of the Eastern Regional Final. Pan out in front of St. John's, 29-26. Game has not been an artistic success, in part because three of the big names that we expected to come up big in this game have not. Reggie Carter, the leading scorer for the Redmen, averaging 15 a game, has tossed in just 2 points for Lou Carnesecca's troops. Wayne McCoy, another big man for St. John's, picked up his third foul with 11 and a half minutes to go in the first half. He took to the bench, and Tony Price, the Ivy League Player of the Year, picked up his third foul with 5:58 to play in that first half, so he took to the bench also. So it stands at 29-26 right now. You know, as we talk about how surprised we are that St. John's and Penn are in a position to reach the Final Four, we think back to all the great players who will not be there, and one of them certainly is Louisville's Daryl Griffin. He's a man who's always had great jumping ability, always had great offensive ability, but in order to help him out with his defense, he turned to an unusual method, as Larry Sacknoff reports.
Louisville's Daryl Griffin is a 6'4" guard with phenomenal leaping ability. He has a vertical jump of more than 48 inches, but Griffith lacked concentration on defense, so Coach Denny Crum sent him to Dr. Stanley Frager, an educational psychologist on campus who had used hypnosis to help other athletes.
Well, you know, everybody gets the idea of us, you know, the hypnosis thing with the, you shake the clock in your eye, it puts you in a trance, you know. It's really not none of that, you know. We just sit down and rap like me and you are doing now, and I just concentrate while we're talking and relate that onto the court.
There's a lot of misconceptions about hypnosis. People, there's a lot of mysticism and hocus pocus, but it really is just relaxation and concentration.
You just more mentally aware of what's going on. I'm not really a different person from it. I'm still the same person. While I'm in there talking to him, I'm still the same person, you know. I have total control of myself at all times. It's not no thing where he, you know, takes control of me.
We do what we call visualization, and so we very accurately visualize what kinds of things he wants to improve his performance in. And it's like mental rehearsal. You rehearse yourself doing it, and you do it so many times that it becomes very automatic.
Mostly, you know, basketball is a lot mental more than physical, you know. And you have to be mentally prepared. You have the physical abilities already, and if you get put both two together, you know, it make you a lot better player.
When Coach Crum came to me and talked to me about Daryl, he talked specifically that he wanted some specific things in terms of defense and Daryl denying the ball to his man, and some specific things in terms of what he does around the lane and so forth. And he's very specific in the kinds of things he saw that Daryl needed to improve. And Daryl agreed. It was things that Daryl was motivated to work on. And he certainly has changed in many of these areas and is improving.
Probably the main key is positive thinking about yourself.
Daryl has exceptional jumping abilities. He jumps 48 inches. This isn't going to make him jump 52 inches. Or whatever. But what it does do is that it really brings the kinds of things you want to do and remember right up to the front so that you can do it. And at the same time, stay very relaxed. It's important that you be keyed in and concentrating very intently. And at the same time, obviously, as in any sport, if you're real tense and real stressful, the muscle functions and so forth really start deteriorating. So you have to be both relaxed and intensely concentrating.
If you see seeing Dr. Frager, like a person who doesn't have the physical ability, say for instance, someone, say, I'm using you as an example, yourself, you go out, you go to see Dr. Frager, try to do a 360 dunk, it just wouldn't work because you don't have the physical abilities. What he's doing is help you help yourself. He's not really helping yourself. He's helping you help yourself.
Sports psychology really, in the area of skill enhancement, is really in a new frontier. We're just beginning to learn how much we can really improve skills through the use of concentration and drills, and we're getting exceptionally fine results.
Yeah, I get kidded a lot, you know, walking around campus, some of my friends are telling me to come out of the trance and all that, but they don't really know what's going on.
Well, as we all know by now, Darryl Griffin's defense, along with all of his Louisville teammates' defense, came up just a bit short. They did not make it to the Final Four. They lost to Arkansas, which in turn lost to Indiana State. The Indiana State Sycamores provide us with one big story in the Final Four. Certainly the survivor of this Eastern Regional will provide another. But they'll both play second fiddle to the great story that has come out of the Midwest Regional, where Ray Myers, DePaul Blue Demons, have gone on to beat USC, Marquette, and UCLA, and give Ray Meyer his first berth in the Final Four in 37 years. You think back, he started coaching in the early 40s. Now he has finally made it to the Final Four.
Looking just the same as you did last time I touched you. And here I am, close to getting tangled up inside the thought of you. Do you love him as much as I love her?
We might to be impartial in this business. I guess there are very few of us who are not very happy for that fine gentleman from Chicago. We're going to take a break and we'll come back.
Prokeds invites you to share Ed's morning run through the streets of Boston. Running is more than exercise to Ed, it's a challenge. That's why his new Proked T-Racers have Ensolite shock absorbers to cushion his stride, a sure grip sole for all surface traction, and are feather light so he can really fly. Ed may never win a marathon, but when his motor's really humming, he knows he can go the distance.
The preceding message was furnished by the NCAA. We're at halftime. It stands at 29-26, Penn out in front of St. John's. What to look for in the second half? Let's go back to Jim Simpson.
I don't know what to look for in the second half, Brian, but I think you hit it right on the nose. Who would have thought last November when it all started that DePaul and Indiana State and either St. John's or Pennsylvania would be in the Final Four? I did not.
Well, I couldn't have said that, Jim, 3 weeks ago when I made my picks, but I think that we have in Indiana State a top club that's going in there. Of course, DePaul's playing as hot as anybody. And you know, I understand Al was really rooting for him down the wire yesterday. They almost needed me there to counterbalance for UCLA a little bit. But it is a great story. And I think here in the second half, the thing that we're going to have to look for is how long can St. John stay in that zone? That's something they don't like to play, but they played it well in the first half, and it got them back in this ballgame.
You're talking about Al McGuire. Let's see, it was about 28 years ago that that young man at that time was the captain of the St. John squad. He may be rooting by long distance today.
I heard he couldn't play a lick, but he liked to fight.
All right, we're going to come back to Greensboro in just a moment, but now we're in the Eastern Regionals. Let's have this message from the NCAA.
The United States has an incredible 69-1 record in Olympic basketball competition, 8 gold medals and 1 silver. This success in recent years can be attributed to the administration of the Amateur Basketball Association of the United States of America. ABA USA is responsible for conducting all international amateur basketball programs for the United States. It approves all foreign teams visiting our country and sponsored the Soviet national team's recent tour when it competed against various colleges. Its members include the National Association of Basketball Coaches, the NAIA, the AIAW, the National High School Federation, the NJCAA, and the NCAA. For more information, write ABA USA, 1750 East Boulder, Colorado Springs, Colorado, 80909.
A message from the NCAA.
The preceding message was furnished by the NCAA. We'll be back with the second half of the Eastern Regional Final following these messages from your local station.
In Greatest Heroes of the Bible, two brothers, Jacob and Esau, make a fateful bargain.
I'd give anything in the world for that, Stu.
Even your birthright?
Then, a young secret agent risks his life to foil a worldwide conspiracy in the Omega Connection. An exciting...
The Greater New York Power and Sailboat Show. Over 2 acres of exhibits, sailboats, cruisers, engines, and marine accessories. March 20...
Energy. There's a lot about it in the news lately. And everything we see and read about it is a reminder to use good judgment in using energy so there'll be more for all. The people who make Amoco heating oil want to keep your family warm and cozy. By dialing down the heat a few degrees, your house can still be comfortable and you'll be stretching America's energy a bit further. And that's a pretty comforting thought.
Mystery, adventure, and suspense on Cliffhangers, Tuesday night at 8.
This 1979 NCAA Regional Championship game is being brought to you by Pabst Blue Ribbon. Pabst is brewed to be the best, naturally, with no artificial ingredients. And you can taste it. By Lincoln Mercury. See all the 79s now during the big Show You the Light sales drive at the sign of the cap. By the American Express card. Don't leave home without it. And by Champion Spark Plug Company, the spark plug specialists.
Looking for a personal car? Let Lincoln Mercury show you the light with Cougar XR7. Boldly styled, luxuriously equipped. A wide selection of Cougars for Lincoln Mercury's big Shows You the Light sales drive. More excitement? Order this 2.3-liter sales drive special Zephyr Z7. And you can get a special auction package added at 50% off. We're out to sell a total of 200,000 cars in 6 weeks.
Let your Lincoln Mercury dealer show you the light.
I've got a nice business, but I'm no whiz at financial planning. Fortunately, my Connecticut General representative is. He sure comes through for me.
Come in through for you. That's what CG people do.
My company needs an insurance representative as professional as our lawyer, tax advisor, and accountant. And Connecticut General always comes through.
Come in through for you. That's what CG people do.
Call us. We'll come through for you, too.
Give me a smile with everything on it, and I'll pass it on.
So give me a Coke when you smile, and I promise to pass it along. I'm gonna pass it along. The world needs a break when it's tired and thirsty. Coke and a smile is how it should be. Coke adds life. Coca-Cola adds life.
Your engine isn't starting on cue. Put in a fresh set of Champion spark plugs at least once a year. Champion and your engine can make beautiful music together. You can't buy a better plug.
Jim Simpson, Billy Packer, Brian Gumblin, Greensboro. Billy looking at the statistics. I go right to the field goal percentage and the turnovers. One is not too good. Well, neither one is any good.
Well, let's be honest, Jim. That was not a good first half of basketball on the part of either teams. It was not fun to watch from a standpoint of artistic basketball. And, of course, when you shoot under 40% both squads and you have 23 turnovers in a game, I'm sure both of these people can play a lot better than that. The thing that surprised me most, Jim, is the emotional pitch in which both of these teams are right now. The kids don't seem to be real fired up for it. You can look at their faces, and it seems like this is kind of anticlimactic for them. And, you know, to get to the Final Four is a big thing, and they're going to have to put something into it in this second half.
Bobby Willis leads all Pennsylvania scorers with 10. And on the other side, St. John's, their top scorer also with 10 is Ron Player. Remember, Pennsylvania's in the deep maroon, the darker uniforms. And St. John's controls the tip-off. Rentscher 5, Carter 35, Blair 22, McCoy 55, Gilroy 43. Blair takes the first shot of the second half, and that's the way you get things close. It's 29-28. Willis 32, Weiss 35, White 21, Smith 20, and Salters 3, the Pennsylvania starting five.
A little better intensity out here now on defense.
Weiss goes up. And now has 8 points. He and McCoy, remember, each has 3 personal fouls. And again, hold the phone, folks. Here come those streamers from Pennsylvania as they got the first basket of the second half.
I think they're just happy to see him get a basket. I mean, this is kind of ridiculous to throw things on the court here when the game is already in the second half.
31-28. And the story all over North Carolina is the empty seats at the Greensboro Coliseum, because Duke and Carolina both were bumped. And you're looking at the ball clubs that bumped them. St. John's took Duke, Pennsylvania took Carolina. They're the ninth and tenth seeds in the tournament. That means next to last and last. And here they are playing for the right to go to Salt Lake City.
Good hand.
McCoy has the ball blocked by Price. Now Gilroy goes up and McCoy follows and misses. And it is Claire that controls.
McCoy got away with a foul there again. That would have been his fourth. He had good hands on the catch.
There's the feed to McCoy for the stop.
Nice pass.
31-30. Pennsylvania. And this time, St. John's fans reciprocate by throwing stuff on the floor.
And Luke Onoseko, who's a real good basketball man, said, hey, come on, let's go. Let's play the game. Let's get our guys in this ball game.
They're taking it out of them by stopping the play.
Man-to-man by St. John.
White way outside, beating a Price at the top of the key. Shoots and scores.
Boy, Tony's off the second half. The intensity has really picked up. You can just tell the players realize what's at stake here. 2-2-1 full court press.
All 4 points, second half for Pennsylvania by Tony Price. Later today, you've got Michigan State and Notre Dame from Indianapolis. Don't miss that. Rentscher from way outside. No, and Gilroy follows no. Matt White with the rebound. Willis slows it down. Salters loose in the corner. Feeds underneath to White, who puts it up and misses the shot. Picked up by Smith. He loses it. Rentscher's got it.
It's Bobby Willis, a good basketball player. See him right there. Stop the fast break all by himself.
Pennsylvania, the man-to-man. Rentscher takes the shot, no good. Claire comes out with it. He'll start again. Claire, the sophomore, kind of dominated the first half for St. John.
That's a walk.
That's a walk on Carter. Started right, then left. Came back, moved both feet.
You know, I really don't understand, Jim, the emotional attitude of the players. Look at right here, the two guards from St. John's just walking back down court. I know the coaches are fired up wanting to get in this, but the teams look like they're emotionally drained.
Carter just looked up the scoreboard clock. It shows 17 and a half minutes to go and a three-point difference. That's Willis. French is on him. St. John's also the man-to-man, as Smith scores from outside. Smith had 2 buckets early on for Pennsylvania. That's the first basket he's had since way back early in the first half.
Well, Timmy Smith started that West Philadelphia ball playing so well at the high school, that turned out Tillman and turned out Gene Banks. And of course, Ross of Penn played there also. It really has been fertile grounds for the recruiters.
Pennsylvania by 5. Carter misses. Claire has the ball knocked out of his hands by Price. Pennsylvania running the ball. Salters passes off to Price, who puts it in. And
he's fouled.
And it's fouled by Rentscher. And it's Rentscher's third personal foul. And the third basket for Price in this half.
Well, Penn is certainly involved in the game emotionally a lot more than St. John's at this point right now. Bobby Willis setting the stage, and everybody's hustling out there. Onoseko wants a timeout.
Well, I don't blame him. There's a 7-point difference at one time. It was 31-30, and now it is 37-30, and Price is going to the line. 16:46 left, and St. John's has called timeout. They got to get reorganized. We're down by 8 at one time in the first half.
Do you know me? When I sing at the Met, I hear bravo, bravo. But when I travel, I hear who? So I just got an American Express card. with these hotel and restaurant in place like London and Paris treat me royally, even if I am not dressed like the Duke in Rigoletto.
To apply for a card, look for this display wherever the card is welcomed.
The American Express card. Don't leave home without it.
Looking for a luxurious mid-size car? Let Lincoln Mercury show you the light with Mercury Monarch. Order this 4.1-liter Monarch, and you can get a package of special options at 50% off during our big Shows You the Light sales drive. More value? Order this sales drive special 2.3-liter Bobcat, and you can get a special option package at 25% off. We're out to sell a total of 200,000 cars in 6 weeks.
Let your Lincoln Mercury dealer show you the light now.
On Sports World, the wild and woolly All-Ireland Hurling Finals from Dublin, plus Notre Dame's annual Bengal Bouts Boxing Tournament, today on NBC.
The Fighting Irish are playing this weekend against Michigan State. That follows this game, and then Sports World, as we continue our Irish St. Paddy's Day weekend flavor. The All-Ireland Hurling Championship, and amateur boxing from the campus of Notre Dame. Tony Price trying to complete a three-point play. He is 4 for 6 from the line. This would be his 7th point in this half. And he has it. 7 points, a little bit more than 3 minutes.
Full court press again. Nobody coming to the ball.
Gilroy did. Now they move it smartly up court.
You know, Price has gotten on track, but Carter hasn't. That's really been the story here in the second half. Penn really getting involved in the game now. They feel that lead.
That's Frencher. 38-32. Pat White has 7 rebounds to lead everybody. Salters. Price from way outside. Smith from way outside. And Smith follows. Gilroy keeps it in. Pennsylvania thought he stepped on the end line. Here's McCoy, the big man. Gilroy's wide open. No good, and White has got his 8th rebound. Flip off. Shorty Price goes off his hands out of bounds. Wrencher for one off for a moment, thought he had fouled, but he had not.
Karnasekka trying to pick up his team. Look at him on the side. He's screaming and hollering, trying to get people excited. Here's the pass right there, knocked out off of Price's hands. We're working as hard as Louis's working, we'd have some kind of game here.
Carter shoots at it. Is tipped by McCoy. 8 points for McCoy, 38-34.
Give Louis Carter second of credit for that basket. He just screaming and hollering over there.
Well, Willis dragged that back foot. And now St. John's, moments ago, Karnasekka was screaming because he's down by 8. Good pull with
it. Look at the man right there. He's a winner. He's involved in this ball game.
Last time down front, Pennsylvania was in the zone. Now they've gone back to the man-to-man. Player underneath puts it up and in. And hold on, they're within 2 again. 6 straight points for St. John. And that's a foul on Richard, and that will be his 4th.
You know, it's amazing what a coach can do on that side. Look at, he's got a sweat up on the head. Louis Karnasekka been around for a long time, and I credit him with the comeback, Jim. I really do. He's the guy in the sideline, got them all going. Here he is, leading the cheers, running the show.
It's the old line of Al McGuire. A team is an extension of its coach. Well, Karnasekka got excited, and he got him excited.
That's right, brought him back on his own.
Gordon Thomas has come in to replace Wrencher with his 4 personal fouls.
Still man-to-man out there.
St. John showed us a bit of zone in the first half. Price driving on Gilroy and gets it in there.
Now, you noticed in the first half, Claire was on Price, and he really did a good job. I'm really wondering why they went ahead and made the change to Gilroy, because Claire's not in foul trouble.
You can see the eyes of St. John's. They are excited now, that is, compared to what they were the first minute or two.
No reason to be down for a game to get you to the final 4. Back to the zone is Penn. Carter still hadn't been able to get on track.
Carter's only got 2 points. And Saunders has the turnover. Takes the shot himself. It is no good. Whistle underneath. Big foul here.
Oh, it's going to be on Wright. On White.
On White, that'll be his 3rd. And Matt White.
We both thought it was McCoy pushing off on the inside.
Big difference. On a second round, he'll whip him up. At the other end of the court, Juan Auer is doing the same thing for Pennsylvania. 14 minutes left. 4 points between them. Tempo of play has picked up perceptibly here in the last couple of minutes.
Good zone.
Gilroy has not been effective shooting from outside. He has 2 points from the foul line. Well, they wanted a foul on that, but no foul call. Schroeder's got the basketball, and he lost it. He absolutely lost it.
Jim, there really was no fast break available for Salters that time, and took it one dribble too far. Bob Weinauer wanting the call. Carter Seca wanting the call. These guards on their own come out of the zone, Jim. You notice, and they almost play man-to-man on the ball a little bit. Leave some holes behind them, but their teams fill in very well.
As McCoy from outside. He's got 6 points in this half, 10 altogether. St. John's has crept within two.
In all their big comebacks this year, McCoy's been the guy in the second half. Came out of foul trouble and really turned it on.
Whistle. 3 seconds?
Yeah, 3 seconds on Pricey. He had excellent position inside, didn't get the ball, couldn't get out of the lane. Here, Louis. He liked it.
12:59 to go. Hall is coming in. And Leafson is coming in for Pennsylvania. Salters goes out. And White goes out.
Both coaches up off the bench, center court, running the show.
Ball knocked away by Price. Belongs to St. John.
Oh, did he call a foul? Yes, he did, for reaching in. That's a big one. Bob Weinauer looks at the bench, and Louis walks up to half court. He's doing everything but take the ball in bounds. Weinauer says, I've got to get the man out of there. It's going to turn out to be a coach's game, Jim. Both of them really having to be the motivator.
From the corner, Thomas in and out, followed by McCoy. Remember, Price now has 4 personal fouls. It's a tie game. And the best player of Pennsylvania, the Ivy League most valuable player, has 4 personal fouls.
Of course, they're playing the zone, but let's see if St. John doesn't try to attack him before they can get him out of the game. Here they got a chance. He's coming out now.
St. John's trying to get ahead for the first time. They've crept up, they've tied, but they haven't gone ahead. They got a shot now at 40 all. They've been down by 8 on several occasions. Hall goes up and is fouled by Carter.
Boy, how many times have we seen man-to-man out of bounds get a team in trouble? There it was again. Carter gets caught on the high screen right here. You see him trying to go around the top, gets picked off. Nobody helping inside. McCoy doesn't even see where the man's going. Too late now. Carter gets hung up for the foul.
Basket counts, and Ken Hall has a chance for his 5th point. Makes it. This will be the second 3-point play for Pennsylvania in this half. And it's 43-40. Price, remember, is on the bench. Vincent Ross has replaced him.
Carter's nice and patient, bringing the ball up court. But they have, with him playing the point, they haven't been able to get him in a shooting position.
Along the sidelines, player, he's been dynamite. What a player's player. 16 points.
He's played a fine game, Jim, and he's doing it without any flair at all. Just playing good, solid basketball.
Willis off the front of the rim. Bounces around, picked up by Hall. And reaching over from behind, I believe, is going to be Carter. And that'll be his 4th.
He'll probably have to come out of there also. And yes, he is going to come out. I'd have to say that both teams lose a big score. Here we're going to see the play. You'll see Carter coming over the top on the foul on Hall. Right there, coming over the top.
Tom Calabrese, the captain, comes in. Cliffside Park, New Jersey. A senior number 4. And Carter, the leading scorer, who has 2 points, goes out. And I mean leading scorer for the season, naturally, not for the day.
Right. Jim, I'd have to say that that's a bigger disadvantage for Pennsylvania. Here's the same play out of bounds. Still man-to-man. But you'd have to say that Price is probably more valuable because of his size and scoring out there.
Two leading scorers are on the bench. Oh, Smith takes it on the baseline and stepped on it. The two leading scorers for the season for each team are out of the game. Four personal fouls each. Pennsylvania by one, 11 and a half minutes left. Later today, Michigan State, Notre Dame. Next Saturday, the semifinals. Next Monday, looking for Coy.
Nice play. Boy, they're getting the big guy rolling now.
10 points for the far this half, 14 altogether. From the side. Shot by Hall, it goes good, but Coy's got the rebound. Blair, he's walking. Could not stop. Stopped to look to throw and dragged his foot.
But they've got the big guy on track right now, and he's not committing any fouls. He came down and double-pumped that ball, just threw it up at the basket. He's a fine player if he can stay out of that early foul trouble.
And St. John's is front by a point.
And they're back in the zone now.
The Redmen have moved ahead. Trailed at half. Trailed by as many as 8 points in both halves. Smith. No good. Gilroy's going to get the rebound and keeps it in. Out to John. Thomas passes.
Oh, no!
And foul.
That's a beautiful layup by Flair. He is, as we said before, playing a solid basketball game. It's a good fast break pass by Thomas. And a nice catch. Here, we'll see it right here. It's a real good catch coming full speed. Puts it up using the left hand and gets fouled.
Now is on Leafson. St. John's leads by three, and it's a three-point play coming up. When Greensboro, 10 and a half minutes to go. For the right to go on to Salt Lake City. Now we go to our studios for this message.
Avis Super Saver rates. Special rates that save you money. Like our seven-day See America rate.
Look out, L.A.
Bye!
Or our special holiday rates.
We get to go to grandmother's house.
Yeah! And on weekends, Avis Super Saver rates can save you up to 50% off our weekday rates.
50% off?
Up to 50%.
See you Monday.
Call our toll-free number or your travel consultant. Some restrictions do apply.
Half the night just to get it right. Now it's all behind. Got blue ribbon on my mind. I've got Pabst Blue Ribbon on my mind.
There are a lot of beers, but there's only one Pabst. It's brewed to be the best, naturally, with no artificial ingredients, and you can taste it.
I've got Pabst Blue Ribbon on my mind.
On Sports World, the Wild and Woolly All-Ireland Hurling Finals from Dublin, plus Notre Dame's annual Bengal Bounce Boxing Tournament, today on NBC.
St. John's has crawled on top in a fine play down by Player, and here it is.
Good hustle here by Gilroy, throws it back in bounds. Thomas takes it up the court. Now, Player, who's had an outstanding game for St. John's, came in, made the good catch, goes in left-handed, gets fouled by Leeson, and he'll be on the line.
Player now has a total of 18 points. Well, he has taken up the slack. Carter has a scoring average of better than 15 and has two. Player has 8 points scoring average and has those 18 and almost 19.
And Jim, I go back to the time when it looked like St. John's going to be blown out here in the second half, got down by 7 points. Louis Carnesecca came off the bench and just started firing the ball club up. It's that time to spring into action, and since then, they've been dynamite.
I think they would admit that they needed that, and he gave it to them. Biggest lead for St. John's. They've never had a lead until just moments ago. They lead by four.
And now they can pack that zone back a little bit tighter, particularly with Price out of there. Bob Weinauer is going to have to think real hard now with 10 minutes to go. He's got to get Price back in there, even though he has four fouls.
As Leafson trying to drive the baseline, ball knocked out of his hand. Now remember, Pennsylvania trying to get to Salt Lake City is trying to get there with Ross 22 and Leafson 40. Both of them are freshmen. Oh, Hall's all by himself, but obviously he's not going to put it up.
Well, St. John's played the zone out of bounds that time because they're in the zone.
47-43, 9:55 left. Somebody goes to Salt Lake. Stepping around, that is Smith. No good.
Thomas has a rebound, and he's crowded by Smith.
And that's going to be the third personal foul for Tim Smith. Fine defensive player out of Philadelphia. Third team foul against Pennsylvania.
Matt White coming back in there. Bob Weinauer wanting to probably go to about 8 minutes, but he's really gambling here to try to keep those big people that he's got, Salters and Price, sitting on that bench.
Matt White has three personal fouls. Not four, three. It is Price that's got four. There's Calabrese. Blair has been something. He has directed the team, the sophomore. Taking charge.
Nice.
There's
pass.
McCoy shooting over White. No good. Ross has the rebound knocked away, but he picks it up. And it was Blair that knocked it away. Now Pennsylvania can draw within two. Get it in. Smith needs, and White wasn't ready for it. And McCoy, did he draw the foul or was it Blair?
Well, Blair raised his hand.
That's what it was, Blair. That's only his second. He'd be willing to raise his hand. Booney Salters is coming back in, and Hall is going out for Pennsylvania.
One pass too many here. Smith probably could have gone up on McCoy. It was a tough pass to handle on the inside. Blair did reach in.
Five personal fouls, team fouls against St. John's, four against Pennsylvania. Much better than the first half when both got in bonus problems early. Salters tries one.
Well, that's a cardinal sin right there. The man with the ball, you might as well guard him. In the zone and not worry about where he might pass it.
St. John's by two. Blair, he just cannot miss. He's got 11 points in this half, 21 altogether.
Same thing in that end of the court, Jim. He's the man with the ball, obviously the most dangerous player.
By the way, spelled his name, P-L-A-I-R. Willis driving the baseline. Knocked Gilroy down. Tony Price is coming back in with 8.5 minutes to go.
Well, I think he's helping clean ice off the floor, Jim.
Oh.
He wants back in there. Bob Weinauer and Luke Arnesek are working so hard on the bench they can almost shake hands half the time. Now, here it is. Gilroy just wasn't at the spot in time. It's hit right in the chest.
Willis goes to the line. He has 4 for 4 from there. 10 points. He's not scored in the second half. Take him off the line. Now, that's only the fifth foul against Pennsylvania, not seven. Not the bonus situation. Here's Willis. You're right, Price retreated to the bench with his ice and towel. ...49-45, St. John's. And there's more ice on the floor. That's Bobby Warner. Billy said, fine football coach, as well as a basketball coach. Came as assistant to Pennsylvania 7 seasons ago, and this is his second year as head coach. And Johns gone to the zone. And from outside, trying to...
Oh, big shot.
Smith. Big point. 8 points for Tim Smith. 47 for Pennsylvania. 49, St. John.
Team's starting to pick up now, Jim. They know what Salt Lake City can mean to them. Intensity's much better.
McCoy!
I think that's a hook. Oh! Gonna be on Booney Salters. Here we'll see now. Watch McCoy hook when he gets his move on the inside. He's gonna use his arm to hook right there. Offensive foul, not called, but Salters gets called for one reaching in.
McCoy goes to the line. He has had 5 baskets in this half and has 14 points altogether. He'll shoot two.
And Jim, no fouls in the second half, right?
That's right. We thought he had one at the other end of the court. He did not. 50-47.
I think it's a matter of concentration for a young player as far as staying out of foul trouble. It seems like he thinks he can just get away with some early in the half. Just goes over there and sit down because it shouldn't happen to him consistently.
Well, here's a sophomore out of Bayside, New York. Salters is not going to get that shot from the corner this time. They come out. So Smith takes it from downtown.
He He's one of those Sunny Hill Summer League prospects. They've got so many of them in Philadelphia that have really come up through that program. And he's showing some guts right now, taking a big shot.
And Johns by a point, 7:20 left. Thomas drives and that's protected. And that will count as a basket for Gordon Thomas. And believe it or not, that will be his first after the outstanding night he had on Friday here.
Here comes Price into the game. Bob Weinauer waited to the 7-minute mark, but he knows he's got to throw all the cards out there now.
Player of the year. 17 points in this game from the Ivy League, Tony Price. Number 15, he is back in there. He'll handle the ball right now.
This gives Penn excellent perimeter shooting with Smith, Price, Willis, Salters, all of them can put up the jumper.
And John's leading by three. As Price, he just came off the bench. Five baskets this half, 17 points. And John's up by a single point.
Penn's picking up the intensity on the defensive end right now. Momentum is starting to swing a little bit.
Marty Thomas driving. Now I believe it's on Willis.
Yeah, Willis holding on the outside. Not allowing any hand touching at all. Thomas showing really quickness there because Willis is a fine defensive player.
Lou Conoseca, 27 years of coaching. 11th year, St. John. Willis now has three personal fouls.
John Kress has assisted him with him a long time, and he's taking a head coaching job and finally leaving St. John's. Been an outstanding assistant coach there for many years.
Each team has 16 fouls. Ball's off the foot of Willis. Still belongs to the Red Bat. That two coaches is something. That's one hour there. You saw Conoseca moments ago. 6:15 to go. Willis reaches number four.
They're trying to get the ball inside to McCoy, but White's really doing a good job positioning. Now they get it in there, and he hacks it.
That's White. And for White, that'll be his fourth personal foul. McCoy had the winning shot the other night. And the battle against Rutgers.
They know that the big man's got a hot hand. They've been trying to get it inside there. White just reached over the shoulder. He's man in motion, isn't he?
McCoy, 1-for-2 from the line. Has 15 points. Short. Well, Pennsylvania almost blew that, but they got the ball back. Trailing by a point, they can go ahead by a point. And John sets up at his own.
That would change some strategy if they got the lead in regard to the type of defense St. John's probably be playing. Price wants that ball.
Smith, couple of big shots here lately. 12 points, Smith, 53-52, Pennsylvania. Time called by Calabrese, the captain. Conoseca, St. John's wanted called. A timeout, and they do. 5 minutes, 33 seconds to go. You couldn't have it any closer. Pennsylvania by one.
When my dad died, Mom said things would still be okay. But they're not, because of something called inflation. I'm not sure what inflation means. I think it means that Mom had to get a job.
Sometimes the insurance that seemed like so much when you bought it isn't nearly enough when your family needs it. Money has a policy that helps keep pace with inflation and helps you deal with a lifetime of changing needs. Mutual of New York. Enough money for the future.
Got your eye on a sexy import? Let Lincoln Mercury show you the light with the all-new Sexy Capri. A miracle at its price. Rack and pinion steering, front discs. Now during our Shows You the Light sales drive, order this 2.3-liter Capri with tack, gauges, and buckets. And you can add a package of special options at 30% off. We're out to sell a total of 200,000 cars in 6 weeks in our big sales drive.
Let your Lincoln Mercury dealer show you the light.
Jim Simpson, Billy Packer, Brian Gumbel. We're in Greensboro, and once this game is over, we go out to Market Square Arena in Indianapolis with Dick Enberg and Al McGuire standing by. They've got the Michigan State Notre Dame game. We already know that DePaul and Indiana State are going to Salt Lake City. One of these two teams, if there's only a point between them, will go. And then the winner of the Michigan State Notre Dame game will go. McCoy has 6 rebounds for St. John's. White leads Pennsylvania with 8, but he hasn't had any lately. But the last 6 or 7 minutes, Matt White's been shut out of the rebounding department and is now operating with 4 personal fouls.
And he's out of there right now. Ross back into the ball game.
Pennsylvania now has 17 fouls. Off the foot of Salters. Salters is a youngster, Billy, in high school, played the Russians. And on a team against Russia. Carter's going to come in, and Connor Second's loading up his best now. Carter, their leading scorer, has only had 2 points, both of those in the first half on one basket, comes in with 5:26 to go.
And Pence back in that zone, backed in with the lead. We'll see if St. John stays in the zone. The fact that they come down score and don't score here, they may have to come back to man-to-man themselves.
Thomas is loose. He's a good shooter. And gets his second basket. St. John's by a point.
And they're back to man-to-man.
Smith, he's been dynamite and makes it.
Beautiful play inside.
5 baskets in this half, 14 points, Tim Smith. Pennsylvania by a point.
And now they're man-to-man.
From way outside, Carter comes through when he has to. Thomas is out of bounds, belongs to Pennsylvania.
You have to question that pass right there, Jim, when you have such a tight ball game, down one. Hard to just throw it up in the air for grabs, taking a chance.
Ross, the freshman in there for Matt White.
Now it's Claire back on Price on the inside. Did such a good job with him there in the first half.
Hold it.
That's all.
Whistle blows.
That's all.
That Carter?
Yep.
He came in, got one basket, and fouls out with 4:22 to go. The leading scorer for Pennsylvania with a 15.3 average fouls out with 4 points.
Well, if we get a chance to see this foul again, you won't believe it because it was totally unnecessary. He was picked off and just pushed away.
Reggie Carter, a junior out of New York.
He's trying to give an explanation for it right there. Now watch it. He's going to get picked off. Good screen. That's just push the man away. I mean, you just playground basketball there. Not a smart play, particularly with 4 fouls on you.
And remember, Price was at the line now is 5 for 7 from the line. Has 17 points. 1-1. Pennsylvania's down by 1. Pennsylvania has tied the ball game.
Fine, pure shooter right here.
He's a senior out of New York. Taft High School, he was New York's most valuable high school player.
Now, here's Louis Karnaseca saying, hey, that man didn't even have the ball, but Louis doesn't realize that the foul was called on the screener, not the man with the ball. He thought it was called, he wanted Ross shooting the ball. Not bad. Good try.
Ross, a 53% shooter and a sophomore. Price does not make this one. We've got a tie game at 56.
Well, if nothing else, it was a good distraction. He's working.
We know we have to give you an MVP, but at 56-0, we're not saying a word. Not yet. Got some ideas, though.
Ooh, dangerous pass.
And Fletcher walking out of bounds. And it must have been a good play because Karnaseca said nothing and it was right in front of him.
Well, he was trying. He was trying over there to make the call. Bob Weinauer right on top of it for his team also. That's a very bad pass, a sloppily thrown play.
Less than 4 minutes.
And a man, and this favors Pennsylvania.
3:45, all tied at 56. Winner goes to Salt Lake, the Final Four.
Being very patient right here.
Price goes up over Claire.
Nice play.
20 points for Tony Price. Pennsylvania by 2. Whistle. Welch is complaining, but I don't think it's going to do him any good. That's a foul, and McCoy will go to the line. The NCAA Basketball Championship is the most prestigious of those conducted by the NCAA. In its 41st year, it is really quite new, considering this is the NCAA's 97th championship year. Today, the NCAA conducted 41 national championships in 18 sports on three competitive levels. This is a message furnished by the NCAA. McCoy at the line is 1 for 3, and that's way short.
The ball was hit for St. John's.
From way up court, one of the officials came down screaming white, and Bob Warnauer comes almost to midcourt.
Nobody hit it. Nobody called it, rather. Bob Warnauer, he's taking a gamble with White on the bench, Jim. He's going to try to hold him out there a little bit longer and see if Ross can hang on against McCoy. Now we're back to the zone.
St. John's trying to tie it up. They're down by two. 3:05 left. Thomas, the good shooter, ties it up. Whistle blows.
We're seeing some real gut shots right now. What Smith made down the deep corner, and then Thomas right there. That's a tough shot to make in under pressure situations in the deep corner.
Well, Smith on the far side. There's Price working over Gilroy. Gilroy fouls him, I believe. And if so, that's going to be his fourth personal foul. But more importantly, it will send Price to the line, where he is 6 for 9. 2:49 left. 58-58. Well, remember yesterday, UCLA came within a point.
Well, see what Gilroy does right here, coming down with the arm. Now watch it. He's right up there with him. When he came down and put the pressure on with the arm is when he made the foul.
Hard to say, Billy. Yesterday, UCLA came within a point before losing by 4. Wichita or Indiana State and Arkansas, outstanding match, one at the buzzer. And now we've got one. It's 59-58 Pennsylvania with 2:40 to go. And we got Michigan State and Notre Dame coming up.
So the tempo really has picked up here. And start of the second half, everybody kind of asleep. The coaches really did a great job getting the players going again.
This time Thomas does not get it. Ball knocked out of bounds and belongs to. And again, Vincent Ross says, hey, wait a minute.
No,
I didn't do it, but he
hit
did.
It out of bounds.
Hey, John's trying to go ahead by a single point to McCoy, who puts it high in the air, and it is no good, and it is brought down this time by Smith. Pennsylvania controls, leading by a point with 2:18 left. And Bobby Warnauer telling Bobby Willis what it is he wants done.
They're still running their offense.
Underneath to Smith.
Oh!
Player walks away, third foul, but it'll send Smith to the line. He has not been at the line before. He has a total of 14 points.
Here we'll see it inside. Player behind him, and he came down over the top, too. Smith has really been getting open inside. Here he is again, Jim. Puts it up strong in the inside. He's been an outstanding player getting loose here in the last few minutes.
2:09 to go. Ross comes out, and Matt White goes in. Although the NCAA has consultation rights with respect to the announcers used on this telecast, NBC makes the final selection of all such announcers. Smith, he's been something in the second half. 60-58, Pennsylvania by 2, but there's a lot of time left, better than 2 minutes.
It's really a winner.
Pennsylvania by 3, and here comes St. John.
With their quickness in ball handling, St. John's can ill afford to allow Pennsylvania to get much of a controlling margin here because they'll sit on it.
Remember, Reggie Carter, St. John's outstanding scorer, fouled out.
Jumping over.
Moving in front. Reggie Carter fouled out with 4:22 to go and a total of 4 points.
Thomas was a little lucky there, Jimmy. Had the jump shot, tried to go a little further. Was able to draw the foul on Smith.
Thomas is 2 for 2 from the line. That was in the first half. And that's a total of 8 points. Foul shots today.
You will see the players talking about it. Had the jump shot, tried to go a little bit further, and Smith hit him with the chest, drove him out of bounds.
And bring them within 1 point and does it. Gordon Thomas, 61-60, 1:54 left.
Nail biting time. Warnauer and Garner second.
I did that yesterday. I've got no nails left. Right way outside. St. John's in the man-to-man. Spence. 133. Remember, just a point difference.
Penn has good team movement. Everybody keeps going. A lot of quickness. Forwards handle the ball very, very well. Bryce and Smith.
120 left.
Gilroy's going to have more pressure on the ball when Bryce handles it, because Bryce will always be open for the outlet.
Here he is again. 5 seconds left.
You've got to have all five men putting pressure on Jim, or the man that you're not putting the pressure on will always be open for the outlet pass. McCoy's picking up. Now reaching in
is Rencher, and that may be all for Rencher. A whole back court of St. John's has fouled out. Rencher goes out with 6 points. With 55 seconds left, and Pennsylvania up by a single point, Calabrese will come in again. But more importantly, or just as important, Booney Salters goes to the line, and he is an 81% free throw shooter.
There's McCoy coming out doing a good job for a big man trying to put pressure on. Rencher just a little late getting there. As you said, Jim, Salters will be going to the line.
Salters has 4 points. And one of them would be a big point. To put him up by two, and 2 points by Salters would be real good.
Bob Weinhauer really did a fine job keeping his two fellas in foul trouble on the bench at just the right time. Got Bryce back in the game. He immediately hit the jumper with about 7 minutes to go. And he didn't want to lose White down the stretch.
Pressure on Salters, hits it. Now you look, and they can score within seconds and tie it. Salters will try to give him just one more point insurance. The ball game is far from over, though, with 55 seconds playing time. She's praying, and she... And he doesn't make it, I'm sure, but he did.
Oh, White with a big rebound.
Follows and misses. Big rebound by Gilbert, and White has fouled out. How quickly it turns around.
Boy, how it turned. Big rebound, had the shot, kind of went up a little bit too quick. And that's why Bob Weinhauer wanted to keep him on the bench. Jimmy needed him in there down the stretch with McCoy starting to pick up some tempo. Here we see it right here. Turned a little bit off balance and then fouled Gilroy coming over the top.
Matt White wondering, is this his last game ever for Pennsylvania? He is a senior, or will he be out there in Salt Lake City? Gilroy, who is nearly an 80% free throw shooter, 2 for 2 in the game, his only 2 points, goes to the line, and he can tie this game up with 52 seconds left. Teams are really beginning to hustle. Both backcourt men for St. John's out. The big man for Pennsylvania out.
Correction, Ken Hall.
Okay, Ken Hall comes back into the game. Now, what that does, Jim, if you take a look at the Penn team out there right now, gives them an excellent ball handling team and a fine foul shooting ball club on the court. So even if the score were to be tied right here, they still have the kind of personnel you'd like on the floor in this kind of situation.
Frank Gilroy, the sophomore from Whitestone, New York, going to the line with a chance to tie it with 52 seconds left. Man.
Well, he looked cool, didn't he?
No doubt. Not the other end. Salters, remember, missed the second end of a one and one. Let's see what Gilroy does. He does not.
Boy, he looked good on both of those foul shots. Nice foul through, nice and calm.
62 all. 48 seconds left. Do they play for the last shot for the tie?
Well, they're going into their offense. Gilroy here on Price. It's a big matchup. Flair on Smith. So two pretty good defensive players playing the main threats.
That's Hall. Blowing it down. 29 seconds. You're watching the clock with us.
I look for a timeout here shortly.
Oh, my. Calabrese did it. Reached him. Reached him. He knew it. Now, Salters, who went 1 for 2 last time to the line. A big couple of shots here. If he makes one, rebound to St. John's, they got a chance to win in the last half minute. If he makes two, well, they're in pretty good shape.
Fine substitution coming up by Bob Weinhauer now. He's going to put some size back in the lineup for defensive purposes.
For that very rebound also, should he miss?
He wants it back here, too, on McCoy. He had such a small team in the game, he probably would have had to play Price on McCoy.
Booney Salters at 62 all, 23 seconds left, has it. Pennsylvania by one.
It's a real big shot right here, Jim, because it put St. John's in a position where they could win it as opposed to this time.
He missed it last time, the second end of the one and one. And does not this time. 23 seconds to go. Pennsylvania by two. St. John's needs a bucket to tie. They call timeout. Timeout. 17 seconds left. Lou Carnesecca will set things up. A lot of games have been won and lost with bigger differences than this. In the last 4 or 5 seconds, we've got 17 seconds to go and a 2-point margin.
When Napa first made the claim that lots of Napa parts are better than your car's original parts, some folks were skeptical.
Better than the original?
Better than the original?
Better than the original.
So before we could make that claim on TV, we were told to do one small thing.
Prove it!
So we did. Lots of Napa parts are better than your car's original parts. So visit your Napa Auto Parts store.
Napa. We help keep America moving.
Hey, did you know that B.F. Goodrich has the best-selling line of high-performance radios?
No.
Did you know they're the most dependable radios Goodrich ever made?
No.
Did you know the Goodrich blimp is taking our picture?
Yeah.
Yeah! Hey, Goodrich doesn't have a blimp.
That's right. We're the other guys. B.F. Goodrich, the leader in high-performance radios.
You know, Jim, that's probably as good a thing to do in this situation as any, is just to say a prayer, because if you think of that game yesterday that took place, it wasn't really strategy, it wasn't tactics, it wasn't a typical shot. It was just a prayer, and it happened to go in there for Bob Heaton.
The score is 17 seconds. It is 64-62. Lou Carnesecca on the far side diagramming what he wants done to try to tie this game in the last 17 seconds. And the way it's going now, we're going to have two most viable players again. Maybe either or. We just got to wait to see how this game goes. We haven't forgotten. We're just not sure. We're not sure he's going to win either.
Got to get the ball in the shooting area. There it is.
Calabrese, the captain from outside. No good. Followed by Thomas. No good. Followed again. No good.
Over.
Whistle blows. Foul. Charge to Gilroy, who fouls out. And they sent him down to the other end of the court, leading by two, 3 seconds to go. And I believe Price is going to the line.
Well, Jim, you said crazier things have happened. They couldn't have had more good chances at it. Actually, McCoy is the one that stopped Flair's chance.
And our most viable player, as you look at Gilroy, is Tony Price. Tony Price, the MVP. He has scored in the second half 15 points, a total of 21. Gillette sends $1,000 to the University of Pennsylvania in his name and a letter to him congratulating him. And at the moment, it looks as though, doesn't it? But you never know, do you, that Pennsylvania is going to Salt Lake City. 3 seconds left. If he misses, there's still a chance for St. John.
Jim, we've seen some crazy things happen. You can remember that Pepperdine situation this year, so it's not over till it's all over.
He didn't get it. Time call.
1 second off the clock.
2 seconds to go. There is still a chance. We remember the 94-foot shot by Pepperdine. We remember Bob Heaton, who won the game yesterday with a 50-foot shot at the buzzer to put Indiana State into overtime against New Mexico State. So don't go away. And we remember also Jaminski of Duke having a chance and fired the ball with about 3 seconds to go in the playoffs, and it didn't go in. But everybody's got a chance. 2 seconds to go, and we'll see the end of it. But right now, as they talk on the bench, we're going to leave Greensboro. Oh, don't you worry about a thing. You'll see the finish of this, baby. Believe me.
Ask your travel agent about United Super Sale. During February and March, savings are bigger, restrictions are smaller.
I told you we'd be back. The Pennsylvania cheerleaders are very happy. Bobby Bowenauer, Weinauer has done an outstanding job. This is the 8th time in 10 years that Pennsylvania's been in there. They beat Iona, then they beat North Carolina, highly ranked Syracuse, and at the moment, They're 2 points up on St. John's. As the 9th and 10th teams in the 10-team field of the MCA Eastern Regionals have reached the finals and have given us a ball game that many of their fans will never forget. And Pennsylvania up by 2, St. John's by a whisker, 2 seconds a chance to score.
Of course, White's not in the ball game, so they don't have their biggest defender, but they're using Price down here in the court to stop the long toss inbounds. They've got McCoy all the way down there on Ross. Here comes the ball.
There goes the ball. It's up for grabs. It's going to belong to Ross, the freshman. It's all over, and Pennsylvania goes on to Salt Lake City and will meet the winner of the game to be played in a few minutes between Michigan State and Notre Dame. Pennsylvania wins 64-62. Tony Price led them in the second half. St. John's didn't catch them till late in the second half, and Pennsylvania fought back. An outstanding game. The Eastern Regionals, a true Cinderella story. Neither St. John's nor Pennsylvania expected to be in the final twosome. They beat the big buddies to get there. There is Bobby Weinauer. Weinauer came from Massapequa down to Pennsylvania as an assistant. 2 years ago made the head coach, and now as a young man is taking his team on out to Salt Lake City. Bobby Weinauer. There he is, Cinderella story, Pennsylvania to cut down the nets. Tony Price is our outstanding player, we told you that. And a big rebound.